heel andere muziek nu. Rod McKuen. Begin jaren 70 had hij een wereldhit met Soldiers Who Want To Be Heroes. Voor het programma De Top 2000 zocht programmamaker Arjan Vlakveld hem op en ontdekte de veelzijdige achtergrond van McKuen. Hij schreef songs voor een groot aantal artiesten. Hij vertaalde werk van Jacques Brel en eind jaren 60 was hij met vele miljoenen bundels de bestverkopende dichter van Amerika. Kijkt u naar een portret van Rod McKuen.
They don't give them out for books. They have no books, so I got mine for recording. Staying alive. Staying alive.
Is that a motto in life then? Staying alive. But listen, bro, what was the story then? It used to be a bookstore?
It used to be a bookstore, and I was the first author ever to sell a million books from this one store. It wasn't one book, it was about three. I had about three books out by then. So that's it, folks.
Yes, sir.
Next.
In me you see a man alone, drinking up sunshine, thinking it's his own. Man who listens to the trembling of the leaves with sentimental ease. Easy to be a man alone. Just make the whole wide world your only home. Don't talk to strangers. Someone might be kind and muddle up your mind.
It's an old house that was built in 1928. I've lived here for about 40 years now. I've recorded over 200 LPs and a lot of CDs. Oh, I like making records. I've written 70 books, I guess maybe over 2,000 songs. 20 or 30 film or television scores. So I've translated a lot of songs, adapted a lot of songs. This is, there's some posters in here. Here's a Grand Gallagher disc from 1972, and here too, the Dubliners, the movie Let It Be Me, so-and-so, the Birds, Count Basie one night, Rod McKuen the next. It's fun now to have written songs with Madonna. I like writing with contemporary people. I did some writing with Kurt Cobain. So it's good, it brings a new perspective. I had been a beat poet with Jack Kerouac and people like that in San Francisco. And I used to read my poetry to Stan Getz and Andre Previn, people like that. So I really started out in jazz. Then I became a jazz singer with the Lionel Hampton Band. And somewhere along about 1965, 66, starting around there, suddenly, everybody began recording my songs. My records, my own personal records were selling. My books were selling. Everything sort of happened at once. So, I was lucky. I mean, I was just lucky.
In me you see a man alone, held by the habit of being on his own.
Sinatra, gosh, Sinatra, from the time I met him in about 1965 to his death, he was one of my really close friends. He was a wonderful man, and him recording a whole album of my songs, the first time he'd ever done it, of any, and he was magic to work with, and he loved songwriters, and it really put me on the map.
7 jaar geleden was hij nog totaal onbekend. Sindsdien heeft hij songs geschreven voor Frank Sinatra. Hele platen zijn er van zijn werken gemaakt. Ieder artiest zingt zijn werk. En wat wel curieus is, hij is de meest verkochte dichter aller tijden. Van zijn laatste gedichtenbundel zijn 7 miljoen exemplaren verkocht. En deze man die geen mooie stem heeft, maar een ontzaglijk persoonlijk, schor, kapotgezongen geluid, maar geweldige warmte en intentie, gaat nu hier voor u optreden. Rod McKuen.
Soldiers who want to be heroes, number practically zero. But there are millions who want to be civilians. Soldiers who want to be heroes, number practically zero. But there are millions who want to be civilians. Come and take my eldest son, show him how to shoot a gun. Wipe his eyes if he starts to cry when the bullets fly. Take his rifle, take his hoe, show him a field where he can go to lay his body down and die without asking why. Everybody, soldiers who want to be heroes, number practically zero. But there are millions who want to be civilians. Soldiers who want to be heroes, number practically zero. But there are millions who want to be civilians. Sticks and stones can break your bones, even names can hurt you.
The reason I brought it is because he signed it back in 1969. And I was hoping maybe I could get another signature. It's one of a whole library.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're legal.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and welcome to another evening of shock and awe. You're shocked to find out I'm still alive. And under your breath, you're saying, oh. Here are a couple of songs that I had the good fortune to write with Jacques Brel. If you go away on this summer day, you might as well take the sun away, all the birds that flew in the summer sky, when our love was new and our hearts were high, when the day was long and the night was warm and the moon stood still for the night bird's song. He's the most incredible entertainer I ever saw in my life. I think I wept the first time I saw him because I knew in my own heart I'd never be that good an entertainer. I wanted to be, but I knew I wouldn't. It was just, he was one of a kind.
Dieu me femme, je vais mourir. C'est dur de mourir au printemps, tu sais. Je pars aux fleurs, les yeux fermés, ma femme. Car vu que je les ai fermés souvent, je sais que tu prendras soin de mon âme. Je veux qu'on rit, je veux qu'on danse, je veux qu'on s'amuse comme des fous. Je veux qu'on rit, je veux qu'on danse, car c'est qu'on mettra dans le ton.
I heard his song, Le Moribond, which I later turned, you know, turned into Seasons in the Sun. What I did is I heard it, I adapted it without even getting his permission, and I put it on an album, and I called the album Seasons in the Sun.
Wish for me and I'll be there.
We had joy, we had fun. We had seasons and the sun. But the wine and the song, like the seasons, have all gone.
And I think we got along together because he always thought of me as a Westerner. He used to call me Mr. Washington because I was American. One time I was in Brussels with him and there were a lot of people, and this mob was throwing stones at this building. Ollie, Ollie, Rod, Ollie, Ollie. And so I came and picked up stones with him, and we were throwing stones. It turned out to be the American Embassy.
What was the reason?
I don't know what the reason was. Who knows what they were protesting in Belgium that day? I don't know. But Brel was all for getting involved in the protest.
Et de vagues rochers que les marées dépassent et qui ont à jamais le cœur à marée basse.
The French language is just one of the most descriptive languages in the world. And there are things you cannot translate. And when I can't, I will come as close as I can.
Le plat pays qui est le mien.
Brel wrote about the flatland, which is Belgium, and certainly it describes Holland to a T. But my homeland was the far west. And so I call le plat pays the far west.
And now the tumbleweed is rolling down the plain. Chased down the dunes by dust that's never known a rain. It runs as frightened as a rabbit to its distant lair. Down the diamond desert, only God knows where. Above the hills, the clouds wait silently, as if they knew some secret, not yet part of me. In the far west, my home.
You know, there are some people who are addicted to liquor, and some people who are addicted to orgies, and some people who are addicted to dope. I am addicted to making records. I don't know why it is, but I suppose it seems like I live half of my life in a recording studio. I have 70 albums out now, and perhaps another 20 recorded that nobody has ever heard. I know that I have about 250 songs in my basement, fully orchestrated, that have been recorded, that nobody has ever heard except the musicians who are on the dates.
I used to book studio time and just go in and record 5, 6, 7, 8, four more songs there. Only 3 songs on this one. So there must have been, I'd record in the morning, afternoon, evening, sometimes I'd do 4 sessions a day. 4 3-hour sessions. I come back with trunkloads of tapes. Some I play, some I just never got around to. Here's demo songs of mine. What is this? So the next guy comes along, I wrote that for Barbara Streisand. She never recorded it, so there it is. Special Star, I have no idea what that goes like. These are things made way back in the 50s. Love is a Feeling, I don't know what that is. We can put one of these things on and see what it sounds like.
Yeah.
Do we dare?
Love is a feeling.
Is this 45? I don't think so.
Come and go. Just like an ocean, emotions ebb and flow.
Ugh.
I know this is true.
Do you remember?
No,
do you recognize the voice?
Have no idea. Please, somebody I hired to sing. I wrote this for Tony Bennett, and then I wasn't satisfied with it, so I never let him hear it.
So
but I wanted somebody who sang sort of in the Bennett manner, you know.
just like
me on the piano.
The season that changed throughout the year.
Who is that lady? Who's that? Who's that lady I saw you with last? Oh, we can't play that. Look at that. Oh well. Well, I think we've heard enough of that. Anyway, I'll listen to it again sometime, I guess. But I'm not altogether unhappy with it, but it seems odd. It's turned a wholly different part of my life, and because of that, I don't even recognize it. I do remember that it was for Tony Bennett. That I remember. But, God, maybe I'll find something good here. Who knows? It's like, here's a film score for a Western called Scandalous John. Here's The Prime of Miss Jean Brody, but...
For that you were nominated, eh? For an Oscar.
Yeah, I was. And I was also nominated for a boy named Charlie Brown.
But seeing Charlie smile can make you stop a while and get you feeling glad you. He's only a boy named Charlie. A boy named Charlie Brown. He's just a kid next door, perhaps a little more. He's every kid in every town.
Here is all pop artists. Over here, that's all big band. Over here is country and Western and folk and spoken word. These are all Broadway shows and composers. On top, all the way around, are operas. This is all classical music over here. You can see I'm still unloading things from various places. So it's a problem. There's always something I want that's in storage, which is why I'm building a new house. I mean, the idea is to build a library that will... Various colleges have been after my record collection because it's considered the largest private collection in the world.
I know some people who ain't much for action. I'd rather sit around and merely talk. Talk is cheap, and the nights go on forever. So I'm building my home up on a rock.
The barn, which isn't really a barn, it's a three-story kind of loft with shelves on both, on two sides, art on the other side, and all glass on the front. It starts just about here and goes all the way to that rock. And it's gonna be a pretty big structure. What will eventually happen is throughout the property there will be small cottages, maybe two rooms. And my foundation, after I'm gone, will provide for students, for young people to come up here at no cost. They don't have to do anything. They can vegetate. They can write a concerto if they want, or they can paint if they want. If they don't, it just gives them time away to be by themselves, to get in touch with nature. I never had that when I was a kid, so I got away to the whole world, kind of. But that's what I want to do with. And then, of course, the barn will have a library of all the records, all the books, so that people can come and learn about all kinds of different kinds of music and things like that. And that'll be the main barn.
Is that also why you start collecting, because you had so little as a kid?
Yeah, really and truly. I never had... Anyway, if it was a choice when I was a kid between buying a steak or buying a record, I always bought the record. always.
I have been a rover. I have walked alone. Hiked 100 highways and never found a home. Still and all, I'm happy. The reason is, you see, once in a while along the way, love's been good to me.
When I was a kid, oh, back in the 40s, I was 8 years old when America got into World War II. I was living with my stepfather and mother, and my stepfather was a chronic drunk. He used to come home and yank me out of bed and beat me up in the middle of the night, and that can get very old very quickly. So I ran away from home, and I didn't have any schooling then. I haunted libraries. I learned from people. I did all kinds of work. I worked on ranches for a while. I worked in a rodeo, all kinds of stuff. There used to be a radio show called Your Hit Parade on radio. And I'd listen to it at the bunkhouse at night. And then when I was herding cattle the next day, I'd try to remember the songs. And I couldn't, and so I'd start making up words to them. Before I knew it, I was writing.
I'll catch the sun. I'll never give it back again. I'll catch the sun and keep it for my own.
I don't think that somebody should have to have a 12-foot bookshelf to understand a poem I've written. I think poetry or music or any of the arts, painting, film, should be accessible. And any writer who tells you he's writing just for himself, that's probably bullshit. I write to find out about myself, definitely. That's why I've probably never needed a psychiatrist. If I had a problem or trouble or something, if I wrote it down and got it out of me on paper, I could always understand it better. But you also write to communicate. You know, if you have ideas and thoughts and you learn things through difficult times, you should pass those things on. That's what we're here for.
Call Big Bear for some reason, right?
Well, he was always a wanderer. He was always, you know, one time he disappeared, and he was working on Bing Crosby's property as just a farmhand. He was always off doing something. But usually one of us knew where he was. One of us knew where he was, but...
He's always been a loner.
He's always been a loner. Always been a loner. And he's still a loner. You know, he loves like this. He loves getting off like that by himself.
It's one of my favorite places on the whole property. All of this rock is flat.
He's gonna get his butt up here one way or another. He loves this place.
And I love these trees.
But we've had the property now for about 3 years. I don't know what Rod is thinking, but it'll take another, before you develop it, if we wanted to live in it and do what he wants to do with it, it's gonna take another 3 years to do that.
Right.
Well, by then we'd be dragging our asses up here. You know, we're not young anymore. You know, like he said, when I get old, how much older do you wanna get?
I'm recording all the time. I've just done a brand new album with Petula Clark. It's the Mafia.
Thank you for Christmas, the first one I remember. That was more than just another day deep in December.
That whole time.
So for all time, in years to come or past, I wanted you to know you gave me Christmas, Christmas,
Yeah, she's gonna get that. It's gonna be great. No matter where I go,
no matter where I go, where I've been.
Right.
No matter where I go. No matter where I go.
No. It sounded pretty good. Let's listen back.
It's better every time. You should listen to those. I tried to retire once. I just couldn't do it. Age is, chronology means nothing. As long as you keep your brain working, as long as you find something that you really can set your teeth into or that make your balls tingle, you know? I mean, something that really, there's something sexual about working. Now, there's something that, I don't know, it's just, working is better than just about anything in the world.
Okay, so what are we gonna do about this lyric? I suppose that I knew even then.
Off beyond your what then? Off beyond your...
Nakedness.
You want me to do nakedness?
Why not?
I think it sounds a little bit out of place in this song.
I was afraid you'd say that, critic.
In which case, maybe this whole song is a bit...
No.
Blasphemous.
It's not blasphemous at all.
Every time I'm in your arms, it's Christmas once again.
As for you, my holiday friend, every time I'm in your arms, it's Christmas again.
My holiday friend?
Yep.
So this is just a fling, then?
You're reading too much. You've taken them too far down the line.
I'm sorry, but
for crying out loud, he just gave her Christmas. What do you want?
This is a woman thing.
You got him on the way to divorce. No, I'm saying he just gave her Christmas.
A woman would know about this.
Okay.
Women know, you know.
All right. I know that. It's true.
It's just a holiday thing. Yeah, it seems kind of rude.
I smell liquor on your breath. Where the hell have you been?
Yes.
Every time I'm here, it's Christmas again.
Again.
That was more than just another day deep in December.
I think you always want to do more. But I'm also sensible enough to know that I can't do certain things. But I can try. I don't mind falling on my face.
And looked me in the eye.
And I'm finishing off 21 songs I started with Burrell that were never finished during his lifetime. Some he started and I was meant to finish. Some he started and I was meant to finish them. Some of them I've done almost no English to. And some of them are more in English than in French. And I have no idea who's going to end up doing the French.
Yeah, but is it? Can you like then finish half a French Braille song? Is that possible?
I think maybe? I can. I think I know enough now to be able to do that. And the topics are incredible. There's a song about Christ. There's a song about the rivers of the world. There's lots of songs about nature. Lots of songs about women. There are songs about there are love songs from men to men, which in his lifetime, he never let go of one of those kind of songs. And he was ready to do that. I was so, even though I knew Brel was dying, there's a long way from knowing somebody's going to die, and the fact that they die. I couldn't sing anything I'd written with him. I couldn't talk about Brel without openly weeping. So I left those songs. I'm a little reluctant to let anyone see them. I'd like to have a group of them. And I've gone back to them now, and I've started working on them again. And I'll soon have a whole album of brand new Geef Gezondheid McKuen songs.
And these few precious days,
you came with somebody tonight, be nice to them. If you didn't, look around. Some awfully pretty people here. And I figure it doesn't matter who you love or how you love, but that you love. Take care of yourselves, and thank you for making it a memorable night. Call my little brother.
Just don't stop. We're going right. We're going right to the table.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm calling Edward.
You want to know
what happened? My God. Didn't anybody go home? That's great.
Thank you so much.
You
have given us over the years.
Thank you. It's my pleasure, really and truly. Really.
This lady is Karen Rogers.
Karen, K-A-R-E-N?
Yes.
Hi.
To Alice.
How are you, Rosalind?
Did you sign this one?
Oh, look at that book. Ancient.
You want to see something even more ancient?
Go ahead. Oh, look at that drawing I did.
Now, you want to know something else?
And what's the title of your book?
Rod McKuen songbook.
Oh, it's a songbook.
Yeah. Do you remember? Well, it's hard to remember, but because it's so very long ago. The cellar door in Georgetown.
Of course I do. Of course I do.
Well, you and Mary Cliff and myself sat and with the owner of the club and sat for a long time. I had been married 2 years. And I had found my true love. You've been my true love ever since.
Oh, aren't you nice?
I'll be married 42 years.
I'm not kidding. Yeah, but I'm not kidding. Anything out. It's always the way.
No.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Ah, oh, this is wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you. Gosh, it's amazing.
I love it.
Once was a time. How you doing?
Great. How are you?
I can't remember when. The house was filled with love, but then again, it might have been imagination's plan to help along another single man.
Think you would have worked less hard if you have a life partner?
Well, I'm not sure. I think there are those people who are meant to have life partners, and they do ease the road for them. The closest thing I have to a life partner is my brother, who I rely on tremendously. I mean, and we rely on each other a lot, and it's a good relationship. It's tough, like any relationship. But I'm a loner, basically.
And always been.
Yeah, and I like, and people get solitude and loneliness mixed up. They're so far apart from each other. You have to earn solitude. If you're lonely, you're usually feeling sorry for yourself.
Alone, not lonely, except when the dark comes on. I'm a man learning to live with memories of midnights that fell apart at dawn. In me you see.
Met zijn 73 jaar is McKuen nog steeds actief. Zo treedt hij over anderhalve week op 7 en 8 december twee avonden op in de Amerikaanse staat Arizona. Daar kunt u dus nog bij zijn. Het is bijna...